Macmillan Audio presents An Affair of Spies by Ronald H. Balson, read by Fred Berman. Prologue. The Letter. On August 2, 1939, Albert Einstein of Old Grove Road, Peconic, Long Island, delivered a typewritten letter to F.D. Roosevelt, President of the United States, White House, Washington, D.C. It was 2 pages in length and, in a dispassionate yet urgent tone, alerted the president to the most lethal danger of the 20th century. The letter began, "Sir, some recent work by E. Fermi and L. Szilard, which has been communicated to me in manuscript, leads me to expect that the element uranium may be turned into a new and important source of energy in the immediate future. Certain aspects of the situation which has arisen seem to call for watchfulness and, if necessary, quick action on the part of the administration." L. Szilard was Dr. Leo Szilard, Einstein's protege, who was strikingly similar to his famous mentor in several respects. He was a genius. He was Jewish. He fled Germany to escape the Nazi persecution in the early 30s, and he was one of the founding fathers of the atomic bomb. It was Szilard in 1934 in London who patented the concept of a nuclear chain reaction. It was Szilard who was the first to use the term critical mass to describe the minimum amount of uranium required to sustain a nuclear chain reaction and its potential to cause a violent explosion. 4 years later, in 1938, Lise Meitner and Otto Hahn at the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Chemistry in Berlin discovered that bombarding uranium with neutrons left a residue of barium created by the breaking apart, or fission, of the uranium nucleus. They were the first to split the atom. Nuclear fission became a reality, and so did artificially created radioactivity. Meitner, also a Jew, fled to Sweden. Hahn stayed in Berlin to become a leading figure in Germany's nuclear program. As clearly as any two people in the world, Einstein and Szilard foresaw the destructive power of a nuclear bomb. The letter to Roosevelt went on to say, "This new phenomenon would also lead to the construction of bombs, and it is conceivable, though much less certain, that extremely powerful bombs of this type may thus be constructed. A single bomb of this type, carried by boat and exploded in a port, might very well destroy the whole port together with some of the surrounding territory." By the time Einstein's letter was delivered in August 1939, Hitler had already marched into Austria and Czechoslovakia with the world's largest and most powerful military force. 30 days hence, on September 1, 1939, he would send over 1 million German troops in a blitzkrieg over peaceful Poland and ignite the Second World War. The thought of Hitler with a nuclear bomb was Einstein's and Szilard's worst nightmare. Einstein knew that it would only be a matter of time until the technical applications of his theoretical work would be achieved by one regime or another. He proposed the immediate appointment of a director to head of a committee with sufficient funding to speed up the experimental work, which is at present being carried on within the limits of the budgets of university laboratories. Over the next year and a half, one advisory committee followed another, while the scientists continued their research in university laboratories scattered across the country. In 1941, Dr. Arthur Compton was appointed to consolidate the research. In 1942, Roosevelt placed the entire program under administrative control of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, with the goal of creating an atomic weapon. Foreign intelligence sources confirmed that Nazi Germany was on the same track, but no one was sure how close Hitler was to achieving that goal. Chapter 1. Camp Ritchie, November 1943. A black Lincoln with U.S. military plates pulls to the side of the road in Frederick, Maryland. After consulting his map, The driver heads north beside the pristine lakes and forests of the Catoctin mountain range. The treetops display a palette of autumn colors on the hills of northern Maryland. There is a chill in the breeze, and the driver rolls up his window. A family of white-tailed deer lifts their heads and calmly watches the car glide by. All in all, picking up a passenger 75 miles from Washington, D.C. on this fall day has turned into a pleasant duty assignment for Corporal William Johnson. He comes to a stop at a crossroads, checks his map again, nods, and turns off the two-lane highway onto Cascade Road, a bumpy wooded stretch that meanders past a crystal blue lake and abruptly comes to a halt at a military checkpoint. The corporal hands a large white envelope to the sentry, and after examining the contents, the sentry waves him on. "Camp administration office is straight up on your right," he says. As the corporal approaches the compound, he has to blink. There are German Wehrmacht soldiers in full battle gear marching in formation beneath an iron sign that reads, "Camp Ritchie." He sees another group of young men in GI fatigues gathered in a circle, appearing to study map coordinates. On the other side of an expansive meadow, he is stunned to see what he's damn sure is a Nazi panzer tank and a German half-track, both with a Balkenkreuz insignia, the white and black cross that is the German national symbol. "What in the hell is this place?" he says out loud. The camp has dozens of stone buildings that undoubtedly serve as barracks. A few are larger and rectangular, and the corporal surmises they must be mess halls and assembly halls. The design of the administration building is no less out of place, with Gothic-like turrets, but to the corporal's relief, an American flag flutters on a 20-foot post. It is indeed an American camp, albeit nothing like Corporal Johnson has ever seen. After a few minutes in the reception area, the corporal is shown into an office where a uniformed officer sits behind his desk. The corporal snaps to a salute. The officer is a full-bird colonel. The bronze nameplate on his desk reads, "Colonel Charles Y. Banfill." His short-sleeved shirt has several rows of bars and ribbons. A lit cigar sits on the lip of his ashtray. The corporal clears his throat. "Excuse me, sir. I have orders to pick up a Nathan Silverman." Colonel Banfill smiles, picks up his cigar, sits back and says, "Do you have a name, soldier?" "Oh, yes, sir, I do. I mean, it's William, sir. William Johnson. Corporal William Johnson, sir." "A pleasure to meet you, Corporal William Johnson. For what purpose are you here to pick up Staff Sergeant Silverman?" The colonel has close-cropped gray hair, a ruddy complexion, and a square jaw. "Shall I assume that the envelope in your hand contains your orders? Is that right, Corporal?" Johnson immediately places the envelope on the desk. "Yes, sir. This is for you, sir." Banfill takes his time reading the order. He hasn't been given the usual heads up, and he is curious, if not peeved. "What does the Army want with my Sergeant Silverman? He is a nice young man and one of my best. He's a squad leader." "I can't say, sir. I was just told to come pick him up." "Well, what if I don't want him picked up? I have plans for him. The Army has plans for him. He's fluent in German, you know. He could be driving one of those Nazi tanks out there and you wouldn't know the difference." "That's a scary thought, sir." "I hope so. Where is he going next and why?" Johnson hesitates. He knows his response won't go over well. "I'm sorry, sir. I believe that's in the orders. The reasons are classified." "Classified? You mean I don't have the clearance? I'm a colonel and his commanding officer." Johnson doesn't say a word. He swallows hard. "That's all I'm going to get out of you, isn't it, Corporal Johnson?" "Yes, sir. That's all I know." Banfill rises, walks to the door, and tells his adjutant to fetch Sergeant Silverman. "Tell him to bring his gear. He's been reassigned." 15 minutes later, a stocky, dark-haired man walks briskly to the colonel's office with his duffel. He snaps to attention. "Sergeant Silverman reporting, sir."
"At ease, Nate."
Tapping the envelope on his desk, Banfill says,
"Corporal Johnson here has come to pick you up for a new assignment. Sorry to see you leave us, Nate. I wish you the very best."
Silverman is confused.
"Sir, I didn't put in for a transfer. I'm a Ritchie boy through and through, Ritchie boy to the end. I've been trained to do intelligence work. I intend to go over with my unit when it leaves for Europe. Rumor is we're pulling out in a few months. That's the reason I joined. The only reason. I'm going back to Europe and fight those Nazi bastards for what they did to my community and my family. That's what I've been training to do. The colonel sadly shakes his head. Welcome to this man's army, Nate. The orders say you are to go with Corporal Johnson. It comes from Army headquarters. He's been sent up here to get you. In a limo. Silverman stands his ground. Colonel Banful, sir. I don't want to go to Army headquarters. I don't want to be reassigned. You know my story. What happened to my people back in Germany. I enlisted to go back to Europe and fight. You gotta help me, Colonel. Can't you get these orders rescinded? Banful raises his eyebrows. He holds the paper for Silverman to see. These orders come down from the office of General Leslie Groves. I don't have veto authority here, Nate. Chin up, it might be a good move for you. If General Groves wants you, it must be pretty damn important. The colonel holds out his hand for a farewell shake. The discussion is over. Silverman sighs, picks up his bag, and walks toward the door. Drive safely, Corporal, the colonel says. He's a damn good soldier and smart as a whip. Johnson nods. Yes, sir. I will. Chapter 2. Reassigned. Nathan cranes his neck to watch Camp Ritchie, his home for the last 10 months, fade out of sight. He turns to the driver. Do you know what this is all about? No, sir, I don't. I'm nothing more than a delivery boy. Get my orders same as you. Nathan nods and settles into the soft leather seat. Other than training maneuvers in and about the surrounding hills, he hasn't been out of the camp since he arrived from Fort Bragg, and that was on an army bus with 8 other men. His reassignment to Camp Ritchie was the first of the army surprises. He hadn't put in for that transfer either. He recalls the day he received his orders. He was preparing for parachute training that afternoon when he was called into Captain Lawson's office. I'm recommending you for intelligence training, Silverman, the captain said. The Army's put out a call for recruits familiar with Germany and fluent in the language. That would be you, right, Nate?
Yes, sir. But I'm quite happy where I am. I'm doing my third jump this afternoon. I'm an infantry soldier. That's what I joined up to do. I was studying at Columbia when I saw the poster that said foreign nationals who had received residency cards were eligible for the draft and could sign up. I went straight to the Army recruiting station, passed my interviews, passed my physical, and 4 weeks later I was sent down here. I want to be with my unit whenever we land in Europe. More than most. I got a score to settle. You don't know what they did to my family and others like me. Look, Captain, respectfully, sir, I don't want to be in intelligence. I don't want to sit at a desk and analyze data. I don't want to be a spy. I want to fight. I got a right. It said so right on the poster. Uncle Sam needs you to fight for your country. That's why I joined up. The captain smiled. Hold on, Silverman. No one's telling you to sit at a desk. You're a German emigrant and you have skills that the army can use. You should be proud. From what I understand, you're going to be transferred to an elite camp and trained with other boys that came over here from Germany to assist our ground troops once we start our invasion. Whatever the hell that'll be. You know the language, you know the territory, the customs. You can be very valuable. That's something we didn't have in the last war. But sir, my unit, Captain Lawson closed his file folder. Negotiations were done. I'm sending you to Camp Ritchie for intelligence training. It's top secret stuff. You'll thank me. Get your gear. So Nathan was off to Camp Ritchie, where he'd spent the next 10 months learning how to interrogate German prisoners of war, how to navigate the terrain in France and Germany, and how to distinguish the difference between the German uniforms, insignias, and patches, so that his commander would know the rank and function of any captured German soldier. From map coordinates and aerial photos, he had learned to recognize the churches, village squares, and principal structures of rural France and Western Germany. Now, after all those months of study, and after he has become comfortable with his new role,
The army, in its infinite wisdom, decides to pull him out of Camp Ritchie and send him somewhere else. And to make matters worse, rumors have it that all of his buddies in his Ritchie unit are scheduled to ship out for England in the next few months. Nathan gazes out of the backseat window with glassy eyes. The car moves silently on. Suddenly, his vision sharpens.
"Excuse me, William," he says. "It doesn't take a map expert to know that Washington is southeast."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.